Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Resources for the Future. This morning, we're very pleased to be hosting the release of a major study on the federal policy of how to lease federal lands in terms of the development of coal in this country. And by those lands, I would remind people, are owned by all of us citizens all across the country, not just by the states in which they happen to be located. That's in my personal view, a sensitive issue. I served for many years on the Interior Committee, which now is called the Resources Committee, and there was sort of an assumption by some folks in this country that those didn't belong to the rest of us. So you'll pardon me for seizing the moment to remind us of who owns these lands, as all federal taxpayers are engaged in this process. Well, this morning we're very pleased to have to deal with a topic that RFF has already done some work on. You'll be hearing from Dr. Alan Krupnik, who co-hosts our Center on Energy and Climate, co-leads our Center on Energy and Climate, and who recently completed a study about one aspect of coal leasing, and that's whether or not the leases ought to include the social cost of carbon, which now is being taken into account in most regulatory environments in the federal government. And he's also led major efforts here to look at the risks that are involved and to do a risk of a shale development, a shale gas development, and a fracking in the country, as well as a comparative analysis of how various states approach these issues from a regulatory point of view. But we also have a panel to follow the chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors. We have Kenneth Gillingham. You'll see their names up here, and you have on your seat the fuller biography. I will simply mention about that Ken actually was a research assistant here a number of years ago. I don't know how many, and he may already be getting to not want to know. But also Dr. Michael Greenstone is with us this morning, and Adele Morris, and James Stock. And so we have a very able group of people to comment on this new study that's being released. But I'm very pleased to be able to introduce Dr. Jason Furman. Dr. Furman is the chairman of the White House Council on Economic Advisors. He is a distinguished economist in the United States and has been for a number of years. And as I think probably everybody in this room knows, but perhaps not all Americans know, the Council of Economic Advisors is one of the preeminent advisory organizations of established in the federal government many years ago to advise presidents to help us have effective economic policy in the United States. Well, with that, let me turn it over to Dr. Jason Furman.
Thanks so much, Phil, for that introduction, for organizing this event. And I have confessed, I've spoken, I think, at just about every think tank in D.C., and until today, with the exception of RFF, and I had been waiting for about a decade to be inviting here, I finally gave up and invited myself. So thank you for that. Wanted to provide just a broad-level context for the new report on the economics of coal leasing on federal lands that CEA is releasing this morning. And the report was done under the leadership of Ken Gillingham, who will be on the panel, along with Paige Weber and Lydia Cox on our staff. The motivation for this is something that President Obama said in the State of the Union, where he talked about changing the way we manage our oil and coal resources so that they better reflect the costs they impose on taxpayers and on our planet. You probably all heard him say that. Most of you didn't realize that when he said oil, he really meant it, and came out a few weeks later for a proposal for a $10 a barrel fee on oil that would fund a $312 billion 21st century infrastructure proposal. That, of course, is a legislative proposal, and last I checked, has not yet passed the Congress. The other thing that he was talking about was a process underway got underway at the Department of the Interior under the direction of Secretary Sally Jewell, who directed the Bureau of Land Management, to prepare a programmatic environmental impact statement for the first time since the 1980s on reforming the way that we do our coal leasing. That's a very serious multi-year process, but it's one where there's a substantial amount of administrative discretion for the Department of the Interior. And their goal in it is to not just look at issues like fair return for taxpayer, but also a broader range of issues, including the environment, the economy more broadly. CEA's report is designed to help with one part of that thinking, and that part is about the fair return for the taxpayers. And that's largely the scope of what we did, not to say that the environmental externality and other issues aren't very important, and I assume you'll be discussing those further on the panel as well. In terms of ensuring a fair return for taxpayers, we currently do auctions, royalties, leases, a whole range of things with all sorts of other resources that, as Phil said, are federal resources. We do it with rights to parks, land, spectrum, and property auctions at the GSA. Of all of these, the ones I personally have spent the most time on is spectrum auctions. And I can tell you there, the system was designed in 1994 by a Nobel Prize winner, Paul Milgram. And we didn't just stick with the 1994 design. The FCC is in the middle of an auction now, which is even more sophisticated and probably more complex microeconomic, consulting and designing it, and probably everyone doing the bidding went into it, than what we saw in the 1990s. Similar National Forest Service land, you can pick up papers in the JPE that are related to what's done there. In contrast, coal basically hasn't been changed since the 1980s. And since then, the number of flaws in the way we do pricing of coal on federal land have only grown or become more apparent. There's a three-step process for federal coal leasing. The first step is bonus bids, a sealed first price auction, to have the rights to use the land for 20 years. And as GAO has documented, in 96 of the 107 tracts leased over the last 23 years had a single bidder. And in many cases, that bid was just above the sealed minimum that was required for the auction to be completed successfully. The second step is a rental fee, which is at least $3 an acre minimum, and that raises very little money and isn't particularly important. The one that raises the most money right now and that will be the focus of the new analysis that we have in our report today is royalty rates. And royalty rates have a statutory minimum of 12.5%, but there's two ways in which you end up collecting less than that. The first is there's a set of royalty waivers, suspensions, or other reductions if they're, quote, necessary to promote the development or operate in an economic matter. And those lower the royalty rate on the reported price of coal below that 12.5. But then second, the royalty rate is applied to the reported price of coal. And if you adjust for the active price of coal, for example, taking away inflated costs for washing and transportation, and even some allegations that in some cases you do things like you sell your coal at a low price with a penalty payment that you basically automatically get the royalties applied to the low price, not to the penalty payment, you take those things into account. And one study found the rate on the actual price was as low as 4.9%. These problems have become more consequential over time as the amount of coal on federal lands has risen. In the United States, you have coal you have Eastern coal, Appalachian and Midwestern, and you have Western coal. Eastern coal is almost all on private lands. Western is about 80% federal land. And the biggest and cheapest there is the Powder River Basin in Wyoming and Montana. And you look at the trends over time, that's the Powder River Basin River Basin is where you've seen most of the growth in coal production. In 1990, 24% of coal was on federal lands. By 2000, it had risen to 40% and stayed a little bit above it since then. So these problems with coal were probably a problem in the 1980s. They've grown, and the issue itself has grown. Another way of looking at how this issue has become increasingly important over time is to look at the prices of coal in different regions. And there's an awful lot of lines on this graph. Just to summarize it, though, in the 1990s, Appalachian Interior coal ranged from about $15 to $30. And Powder River Basin coal, is that bottom dotted orange line, was about $10. Fast forward to today, you see coal prices ranging from about $30 to $100 in the rest of the country. The only line there that's really boring and uninteresting is the Powder River Basin, which started out towards the bottom, ended up towards the bottom, and has been pretty flat, with a ratio of 5-1 for southern West Virginia to Wyoming Powder River Basin today, as compared to 3.3-1 in 1990. Now, there's a bunch of things going on here. Partly, surface mines are cheaper to extract coal from. There's different types of coal that have different prices, different differences from markets. But public policy has played an important role in this. It's also the Powder River Basin coal has depressed the national price of coal and resulted in less production of eastern coal. What this report aims to do is to ask the question, if you raise the royalties on coal, what will it do in terms of revenues, in terms of the environmental impact, the impact on coal? And there's a lot of different things going on here. You need to keep track of supply curves in different regions, demand curves, the interactions with regulations. You know, in theory, it's possible, for example, you raise the royalty rate and that results in lower auction revenue or less production and thus less royalty. So all of this is somewhat theoretically ambiguous. You need to use a model, and what Ken worked with was the IPM model developed by ICF. It includes surface and underground. The results are largely driven by surface, and it tries to track all these different effects. What we simulated were four different ways of charging royalties. The first is prices based on nearby coal prices. That has the advantage of your pricing at something similar to the coal that you're extracting. It has the disadvantage if everything nearby is also federal coal from a surface mine, it might all be distorted. The prices, reported prices, might all be distorted by the same factors I was just talking about. If you did that, the royalty charge would be $3 a ton, and the royalty rate, this is all in 2025, would be 17%. That's a little bit of a higher rate than it would be today because the price of coal is falling over time. An alternative is to base prices on non-federal nationwide coal. This has the advantage of avoiding that problem that you're pricing off of the other distorted federal coal in the area. The disadvantage that the coal is somewhat different than what you're doing. Here you get a royalty charge of $5 a ton and a 29% royalty rate. A third is saying the alternative to coal and the production of electricity is natural gas. And you price off of that, it's a $5 royalty and a $29 royalty rate. And then the final thing we did, just as a conceptual exercise to gauge the questions around, you know, what in tax terms would be called, you know, how much of a Laffer curve or is there a Laffer curve in the royalty rate, we looked at what the revenue maximizing royalty was. And there, it's $30 a ton. The rate goes really high because it depresses the price a lot. You know, the point of that exercise is just to give you a sense that we're nowhere near the point where reduced bidding revenues or reduced production would offset the increased revenue you would get from royalties. And in part, that's because the bidding revenue itself is so low because some of the problems I talked about before. In looking at some of the impact of this, these four scenarios, the first three scenarios would all result in small increases in the production of eastern coal, small and slightly larger reductions in the production of federal coal, and modest reductions in coal overall. So this isn't, you know, as some exaggerated statements have said, you know, these types of options wouldn't do anything like kill the federal coal industry. And in fact, for eastern coal, as I said, it would increase. You would see some emissions reductions associated with these three scenarios, and all three of them would result in additional revenues. The maximizing returns to taxpayer option would result in a 50% reduction in federal coal production or coal production on federal lands, a much more substantial emissions reduction and much more substantial revenue. As I said, all of this is just looking at the return to taxpayers. It's not recommending an option, but it's certainly trying to say that in thinking about the option that, you know, we are well below maximizing revenue. We're well below any notion of a fair return to taxpayers, and that's without even counting the environmental externalities, which are not just the carbon emissions associated with coal, which if you had a complete system of climate regulation, you would be fully dealing with, but it also includes the methane that's released in producing the coal, the water and land degradation associated with coal extraction, the issues associated with the transportation as well. So in just about any system, you would still want to take some of those externalities into effect. And if you didn't have a clean power plan, there's some evidence that you could get a very substantial fraction of the emissions reductions associated with that plan by better pricing of coal. And in the presence of such a plan, it would reduce the allowance prices and make it cheaper to hit the goals in that plan. So in summary, there is a real strong case for reform here. It's one that has, you know, many different parts that the administration is taking very seriously, but perhaps chief among them, or at least most obvious and should be most non-controversial above them, is a fair return to the taxpayers. And on that grounds, we're falling, you know, well short. The system is antiquated, and the review that the Department of Interior is doing is a very welcome and important step. Thank you.
This is not my business.
Quite all right. Thank you. I'm Ken Gillingham. I'm the Senior Economist for Energy and Environment at the Council of Economic Advisors. It's always a pleasure to be back at RFF, where I did work over a decade ago. This was a very exciting project, and I'm going to give a little bit of a further detail in what we were really thinking as we were putting this together and what some of the findings are beyond what Jason has put together. He showed all the pretty graphs. I will be giving remarks. The goal of this report was to provide an intellectual foundation on one aspect of the economics of coal leasing. As he mentioned, there are several aspects. There are many considerations, for example, in the PEIS process that the Department of Interior is undertaking. We're focusing on one aspect in this report, not at all to the detriment of the others. One of the things I want to focus on is this turned out to be a far more interesting subject and deeper subject than I had realized when I dived into. You could write an entire paper, as we did, on just the fair return to the taxpayer issues. But given all these other considerations, this is a very, very broad topic. And moreover, this report, which actually now is posted, you can look on the Council of Economic Advisors website and look it up. The paper is posted on there. We don't even get into some of the deeper issues about how to reform the PEIS process or the federal coal leasing system. There's some really fascinating interactions when you think about how bonus bids interact with royalties. We don't even get into some of those issues. What we do get into is considering how you think about the federal coal leasing system from an economic perspective, focusing on the fair return to the taxpayer, and then what are the effects of changing the federal coal leasing system and changing royalty rates, as Jason said very nicely. So Jason laid out a whole set of critiques, and I want to go into a little bit more detail in them. But again, I want to remind you of there are really three components to the federal coal leasing system. They're the bonus bids. This is an auction, first price sealed bid auction, where there's a minimum bid set at, in quotes, the fair market value by the Department of Interior. It turns out that getting a fair return to the that's the primary way that Department of Interior has been aiming to get a fair return to the taxpayer. Turns out roughly 90%, GAO has shown very clearly that roughly 90% of all of these first price sealed bid auctions have had one single bidder. And most bids come in just above the minimum bid, which lends itself to the idea that there's a repeated game going on here. A second component is the land rents. So there are land rental fee payments just per acre of land on this program. But they're largely insignificant, $3 per acre. They've raised $1.2 million relative to the bonus bids and the royalties. It's fairly insignificant. And that leads to the third, which is royalties. Royalties are quite interesting here because royalties mean that this is an auction with contingent payments. So there is a small academic literature not focused on coal that focuses on situations where you have auctions with contingent payments. Royalties provide quite a promising way to bring in additional revenue. But it's very interesting looking at how this program has actually worked. 42% of Wyoming coal was sold through captive transactions. This is a sale between a parent and an affiliate, which means that they can choose the price. If you have a low price that's in the sale, the royalties are taken on that price. Not all of them, so that's 42%. The remaining are sold directly to the end. But for those, there are self-reported deductions. There are two types of deductions that can be given. One of these are washing deductions. So that's a type of cleaning of the coal that's done, a processing step, cleaning for impurities. And the second is transportation. So if you self-report, you can choose exactly what you want to put down. And so logistics costs, other overhead costs could, and many have argued in the literature that those are being included. Third, there is an incentive for coal contracts to be structured with penalty payments. These are take-or-pay contracts with a low price and high penalty payments. So what does that mean? That means you're selling your coal to, say, an electric generating unit, and you can sell it for a very low price, and that's what the royalties are taken on. But built into the contract is a penalty payment if you don't sell a very, very large amount of that coal to the EGU. And if that's the case, then they pay the penalty payment. And they are then required to, they only pay the amount on the royalties on the amount that's paid, and then there's the penalty payment. So it's a way for further to go through. So what the report does is we provide an economic perspective. We lay out how you consider these issues about getting a fair return to the taxpayer. We talk about an idealized world. In an idealized world, the owner of the resource gets all the economic profits. These are profits after excluding the standard return on capital. So these are the economic rents. These would go to the public. And then we compare this world to the world we're in now, where a large amount of these rents or economic rents do not go to the public. And we go through the economics. So auctions are a standard way to do this. We've seen that auctions have to be competitive. Royalties are another way to do this. But royalties have to be based on the true economic value of coal. There's a very nice analogy that can be made to property taxes. In a situation that we all know very well, where we have to pay property taxes, we have assessors go to all of our homes, and these assessors determine what the value of the home is based on nearby houses in the same area that are comparable. Which leads you to the fundamental conclusion that coal, the economic value of coal, should be based on comparable coal. You could be nearby if you find comparable coal nearby, or it could be nationwide. But this takes into account the location, the characteristics of the coal, so the heat rate, the sulfur content, the moisture content, the ash content. All of these should be taken into account. These are all factors in the true market value, the true economic value of coal. Some of these are unobservable, which leads to a real issue with asymmetric information. Some of these are observable, so transportation costs are observable, yet we use self-reported costs. The observable, what, are they observable? Yes, there are metrics out there that we know that you could use to better understand what the actual costs are of transporting 1 ton of coal 1 mile, and then we know the distance. So these are options that are available. What this report does, Jason Furman did a really great job at looking at the coal market today. And so what this report does is take the knowledge we have of the coal market today, noting that federal coal is dominated by a small area of very inexpensive coal that's been depressing prices nationwide. So as I said, federal coal is dominated by Powder River Basin coal. It's 85%. And Powder River Basin coal is quite inexpensive when you count external costs. It's bringing down the coal price nationwide. So we focus on this. We look at two main approaches to ensure a fair return to the taxpayer. One of the approaches is assess royalties based on the full fair economic market value of coal. And again, this gets back to the property taxes analogy. And the second is, as a benchmark, what if we decided to maximize the return to the taxpayer? What if we just examined what that would do? One of the big questions is, when you raise royalty rates on coal, you're obviously going to cut some production. How quickly does production of federal coal decrease? And if you cut production too quickly, it would mean you're actually losing revenues rather than gaining revenues. And that's an empirical question. That's a question that requires modeling. That's the question that we aim to answer. We use publicly available data from a set of IPM runs, so the integrated planning model from ICF Consulting. This is the same model used in a whole suite of federal regulations. It's used in modeling for corporations as well on a separate arm of ICF. And in our analysis, we examined what it would mean to actually raise royalty rates by different values motivated by the economics of the situation. So we examined the price of regional coal on a per BTU basis. We did this all on a per BTU basis in order to at least partly adjust for the characteristics, particularly the heat rate of coal. And we examined the nearby coal, we examined nationwide coal, and we also examined a benchmark, which was what if we actually attempted to maximize return to the taxpayer. Now, that is just a benchmark. None of these are policy proposals, to be clear. These are all analytical inputs to build the intellectual foundation so that we can better understand what the effects would be of these. And we find, as Jason really explained quite well, so I'll be very brief, we can go way up in royalties and still bring in additional revenue. Eastern coal will actually slightly benefit, which is something that Jason didn't focus on as much. We actually can analyze how much Eastern coal from the Illinois Basin, from the Appalachian Basin, will benefit. It'll have a very minor impact on existing operations because we were looking at only at new coal. We modeled changing royalties on new leases. So there'll be a minor impact on existing operations, and that's why, if you'll notice in the report, we focused on 2025 results, so there's time for that to be phased in. We find a modestly higher price for coal from all of this, and we also find some reduction in externalities in a variety of ways. So these results, some of which were surprising to me. Well, first of all, I will say I was surprised. I thought that the whole story was that waivers can be given for coal. So for surface coal, it's 12.5% is the standard amount, and there are waivers that can bring you down to 11%, that can bring you down in some cases to 6% or lower. That wasn't the full story. There was much more than that. Those, for example, in the Powder River Basin, very few waivers are actually granted, and 12.5% for that surface coal is what's given most often. 8% is it for underground coal. So it's much more. It's these deeper questions about what is the economic value of coal. And that's what we've been focusing on. And that led me to the other conclusion, which is it's pretty amazing how clever folks have been in this industry and when looking into self-reported deductions and the incentives for coal contracts. It's been a fascinating way to really understand this industry and learn about its effects, the effects of changing the federal coal leasing program to look at royalties. So with that, I'm excited to hear what the others have to say, and thank you. You're all set.
Okay, so maybe we could turn off the lights so that people can see the slides. So I'm Michael Greenstone. Thank you very much for having me here to talk about this important topic. Okay. So I just want to commend Kenny and Jason, the director, on really what was a terrific CEA report. It analyzed these auction markets for coal and uncovered a series of facts, some slightly unsettling, but was really kind of an exemplary report on this market. So what I want to do is take a slightly different tack. So they analyzed very carefully the function of these auction markets. And I want to take a different tack and look at the environmental issue, which they touched upon, with respect to recovery of fossil fuels from federal lands. And so the way I like to think about it is broadly defined, there are two kind of polar camps out there on how to, with respect to recovery of fossil fuels. If you think back to the, I think it was the 2008 Republican convention, you have the Drill Baby Drill group, and on the one hand, and on the other hand, you have the Leave It in the Ground group. And so what I want to try and outline today is that I think that there's a middle ground that recognizes the tremendous importance of access to inexpensive and reliable energy, which the federal lands play an important role in, and also recognizes the environmental issues related to the use of fossil fuels. So I'm going to put forward what I'm going to call a common sense principle. That I think should not be controversial, and it's just that we should require that the lease payments reflect the full social value of the resources that are coming out of the ground. And so obviously, on the benefits side of the use of these fossil fuels, these fossil fuels power the U.S. economy. There's been a complete renaissance which has altered many features of the global energy market. That was started in North America, not only on federal lands, but since 2005, we've seen natural gas prices decline by 75%, seen petroleum prices, it's a global market, but nevertheless seen petroleum prices decline by 25%. And that's brought really tremendous advantages to the U.S. economy. And indeed, in a period of slow growth, it's unsettling to think of what the growth would have been without this kind of boost from the energy sector. Now, so that's on the benefit side. And on the cost side, the use of fossil fuels comes with some damages as well. And I think that's the other side of the equation. And those, are affectionately known as climate damages. And so the use of the fossil fuels and their combustion inevitably leads to the release of CO2. And that CO2 causes climate change. So the application of this idea is what I think is something that's not very controversial, is that leases should return at least as much as the damages that the fossil fuels are going to do. And then many will have value even greater than those damages. It comes from all the economic benefits. But at the minimum, the leases should return, this would be an environmental way to think about it, what the climate damages are going to do. So how might we determine these damages? Well, fortunately, the U.S. government has something called the social cost of carbon, and that's the monetized value of an extra ton of CO2 emissions. Full disclosure, I was involved in its development. Actually, Elizabeth Kopitz, who I can see in the audience here, and she's trying to hide her head, was also involved in its development along with many, many other people. And the application of this idea is once you can turn a ton of CO2 emissions into a dollar value, then that tells you that if you're going to sell a unit of energy and it has $1 of climate damage associated with it, you shouldn't have a reserve price in that lease. It's at least $1, or it is $1. And of course, the revenues from that can be used for a variety of things. It can go to general federal activities, state activities, climate resiliency. It could also go to help the communities. As Ken noted, lots of the coal is in a relatively small region, and there'll naturally be some economic dislocation, and those communities certainly would deserve support in that transition. But the bottom line principle is that we should use these fossil fuels, and again, I'm talking about coal, but I'm also talking about natural gas, I'm talking about petroleum, that produce more value than the damage they do. That's a crazy idea. And so let's just take a look at a couple slides I made on, well, what are the climate damages associated with the use of fossil fuels from federal lands? And here's the annual damages from using coal. So this is effectively, I'm just taking the embedded carbon in the coal that was produced from federal lands and multiplying it by the U.S. government social cost of carbon. And you can see that the coal mine from federal lands was responsible for about $30 billion of climate damage each year, on average, from 2003 to 2014. If you add in the natural gas and the petroleum, you can see that the number gets, you know, ranges somewhere between, in more recent years, a total of maybe $45 billion, and in the earlier years, maybe $60 billion. So these are substantial climate damages that are being unlocked each time we pull some fossil fuels out of the ground. Again, that's not to say we shouldn't use these fossil fuels, but just that the price that we assign to them should reflect these social damages. So one way to investigate this a little bit further is to look at, well, how valuable are these resources that are being pulled out of the ground, and A, and B, how valuable are they relative to the climate damages associated with their use? And so here, I've just converted everything into the spot price per MMBTU. That's a unit of energy. And what you can see, part of the reason coal is so popular in the energy system is it's really inexpensive to produce a unit of energy from it. You know, I think it's those numbers are 66 cents for coal. The same unit of energy from natural gas is almost $3. And the same from petroleum is almost $9. Okay, and so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put next to those bars the climate damages associated with that same MMBTU of coal, natural gas, and petroleum. And what's striking here is that the monetized climate damages associated with the Powder River Basin coal are almost six times the market value of the coal. So that is every time we are pulling coal out of the ground in the Powder River Basin, at least. And there's different, as the report noted, the price of coal varies across regions. The social damages associated with that, this is globally, are about six times larger than the value that that's producing, and that's, you know, in terms of providing power and electricity. In the case of natural gas, the climate damages are on the order of about 75% of the market value. And oil, which is less carbon intensive, it's a little more carbon intensive than natural gas, less than coal. The numbers are about $9 per MMBTU for petroleum and about $3 worth of climate damages. So what I wanted to come back, you know, I'll end where I began, which is essentially I want to put forward the principle that we should not be using resources that do more damage than good, and the price we assign to these resources should reflect whatever the climate damages are. But to be clear, you know, the fossil fuels have been a tremendous asset and boon to the economy. And there'll be many instances, these are averages, there'll be many instances where it's going to be a slam dunk to continue to use them aggressively. But there will also be some instances, as this chart indicates, where the climate damages are larger than the benefit they're providing for society. So thank you.
So thank you, Michael. I think we at RFF would agree with pretty much every word that Michael said. We did some early work, as Phil mentioned, on this issue over a year ago now for Paul Allen Foundation. And we were motivated by a desire to put an upstream carbon tax in place, and we have a program here at RFF that focuses very intensely on carbon taxes. But we thought we could start that starting with federal coal was a very good opportunity because this is within the government's and particularly the administration's purview. So we looked at the legal and economic justification for reform, and we settled, as did CEA, on changing the royalty rate, that was the best way forward, both legally and economically. So a full social cost of carbon, we thought in the report, would probably end the production of coal on federal lands because it's so high. It's about $94 a ton by our calculation. And the study that CEA relied on, which was funded by Vulcan, agrees. But the interesting thing about that study is they found that revenues from very large royalty rate increases are still higher than they would be now. And that's a surprising finding of the study. We also thought even a more modest charge might be unacceptable legally if it did compromise this revenue-raising approach. But fortunately, the modeling shows that it does not, so it's probably okay. Of course, a tax on federal coal shifts to non-federal coal. And to the extent non-federal coal has different properties than federal coal, like PRB coal, you may have a problem. And one of the things we found was there is a perverse incentive potentially associated with switching away from this low sulfur federal coal in favor of higher sulfur on average non-federal coal. And that incentive, perverse incentives, is it might result in coal with higher SO2 emissions. And this is a problem both for the SO2 trading market to raise its price, and it's also a problem that it takes dry sorbent injection, which is the cheapest technology for reducing mercury emissions, off the table. Companies that utilities have already spent money on this approach to reduce their mercury emissions would find those assets potentially stranded, and it would force other companies to go to flue gas desulfurization, which is much more expensive. So the obvious moral of that story is don't just tax the federal coal, you've got to tax all the coal. And I think this is basically what Michael is saying as well. Oh, you did it? Okay. Well, we'll say that one. So one question I have that I'd like to see somebody discuss if people are here from BLM or DOI is why this review is taking 3 years. It seems like a long time, so I just want to get that out there. And then turning to the paper at hand, CEA, I think, makes three contributions. The first one is to talk about maximizing revenue. I think this is the first study that's really focused on that point, and they're to be commended for that. And the results are a bit surprising, that you could really raise that rate on royalty rates and still see revenues not go down very rapidly at all and go up for quite a distance there. Another is to use the ICF model to examine alternative scenarios than they did in that report. And the third is highlighting changing the base for calculating the royalty rate. We didn't look at that. And that's really interesting because when you change the base, you eliminate these perverse incentives that Kenny and Jason were talking about. What they also want to do is change this rate into a heat rate. And that's a good idea as well because it focuses the rate on the embedded CO2 in coal. And that amount of embedding of CO2 in coal varies a lot with coal in different basins and in different qualities. So it's important to capture that in a royalty system if you're going to, if you're thinking about carbon reductions. One thing that I'd like to see addressed, though, is that the industry does cite a GAO study in 2014 and a Department of Justice study in 2013, which really clears them of fraudulent behavior in the way they manipulate these prices, if they are in fact manipulating the prices. So it may not be illegal, it's just an economic opening for the companies to manipulate their prices. But we need to be careful about this. One question that I had is, the model shows a lot of responsiveness of non-federal coal to federal coal, to higher rates on federal coal. So this elasticity of substitution, as economists would call it, and it's high, and I just, you know, question that. And then the options chosen. So particularly thinking about natural gas prices as the base for the rate. I mean, if the natural gas prices should tank, they're already pretty low, but, you know, in the future, if they go up and then they tank, then using that rate would result in coal price, coal royalty rates going down as well. So I don't think it's like a great idea to tie the rate, the royalty rate to natural gas prices. Of course, if they went up a lot, then the rate would go up a lot as well. I think the one bitter issue is clearly a problem, as Kenny was talking about it, the lack of competition. But the BLM is supposed to set fair market value rates that can, in a sense, substitute for this competition. So if BLM, in its reforms that it's looking at now, can increase their fair market value rates, it wouldn't be as good as having competition, but it could maybe provide a fairer return for the taxpayer and a higher rate that the coal companies would be subject to. And finally, if we are going to get increased revenues from reform, perhaps some of those revenues can be used for communities, for retraining people. You know, you could target the revenues, maybe to build into trust funds. And another point that Nathan Ratledge, who's here at RFF, and Chase Huntley is raising in a paper they're working on right now, they figured out that if you put a charge, a royalty rate, on just the methane coming from mines and the CO2 from all the operations in production, so not going further up the chain to utilities, just in the production level, that would be about $2 a ton. So it's a very modest increase in royalty rates, but one that I think is much more easily justified than some of the things we're talking about here. So those are my remarks, and thank you very much.
Well, hi, everybody. I'm Adele Morris from the Brookings Institution, and I'm so glad to be here today to welcome this paper by the President's Council of Economic Advisors. I want to congratulate CEA on their paper and congratulate the administration on doing this review. I think I learned a lot reading this paper, and the first thing I learned was it's high time we looked at these leasing provisions from a variety of perspectives, both the fair return to taxpayers and the environmental dimensions. And I think this is a conversation that is beyond time to have. I one of the things I learned is like a whole manual of how to game the system. Like it's a, maybe not a tax evasion manual, but certainly a tax avoidance manual. And it was really impressive, just all the different ways coal companies can reduce the royalties that they pay. So I really think that you've done a good job laying out some options. I didn't come away with a strong opinion about exactly what the valuation of the coal should be done. I may probably agree with Alan about the natural gas idea, but obviously you're exactly right. You don't let companies choose their deductions, right, and value those deductions in this opaque way. So So kudos on that. On the royalty rate, I guess I want to start by saying I think coal is special. And in most resources that the federal government manages and allocates to the private sector, I think are different than coal. And I'll explain what I think the differences are. In general, I wouldn't say that the goal is maximizing revenue. You want to be careful about how you talk about that. You don't want the federal government acting as a monopolist to withhold producer and consumer surplus from the market. Like, we would never say, gosh, we should restrict how much radio spectrum we put in the market because therefore what we put in the market we get higher prices for. That just wouldn't make any sense because there would be real social deadweight loss associated with maximizing the revenue from that resource. And as long as we're managing a resource like fish or timber efficiently and sustainably, you want that resource out in the marketplace where people can gain benefit from it. So it's not maximize revenue per se. You want productive efficiency. You want an efficient primary market for the allocation of the rights to the resource. In that case, like the CEA, Jason mentioned, like all these clever auction methodologies for the spectrum. I think those are really, really cool and proper. You want efficient secondary markets in the allocation of the resources so you get that productive efficiency. You also want allocative efficiency. You want the right amount of that good out into the marketplace. And so why coal is different, I think there's three characteristics of coal that I think are essentially unique. I can't think of another resource the federal government manages that has these three characteristics. One is the uniquely significant external cost. And we've talked about CO2, the particulate matter, sulfur, mercury, local environmental degradation to water and land, all sorts of things. So that's one characteristic, but it also has the characteristic that a lot of those external costs are not currently regulated as of yet. These are not, you know, we don't have a price on CO2, and this clean power plan is not in effect yet. And that, I think, creates a special opportunity for social welfare gains to try to raise the price of coal. Now, ideally, I would love to see a price on all carbon across the economy, not just coal. And I really look forward to CEA's next report on carbon tax design. That's going to be awesome. And feel free to give me a call. I'm happy to help on that. So you've got external costs that are unregulated or underregulated. And third, you have pricing power, right? So with coal, I think the coal report that Jim Stock and his co-authors have done showed that we do have pricing power in the federal government. So if we put those charges on coal, those do get passed along. And so there is an opportunity to actually produce cost-effective abatement through these federal policies on the resource. I don't know if we could do the same for oil and gas. If, like, you put a carbon adder on oil and gas produced on federal lands, I'm not sure how much of that you can pass along and what that would do to consumption levels, because the market characteristics are so different in oil and gas. There's a lot more production on private lands. It's a much more fungible liquid. I don't know. Maybe you could do it. But I think with coal, you've convinced me, Jim, that you could actually do this and have some pricing power. So those are the three key characteristics that I think make coal special. There's one more, though, and I think this gives some guidance to the policy. Unlike other resources, I think that if we engage in a policy that prices coal, raises price, those costs get passed along to consumers. So even while we're raising revenue for taxpayers, we are burdening households potentially with higher electricity costs, right? And so you want to balance the distributional outcomes. It might be an efficient revenue instrument, but you have to ask, what are the distributional outcomes? And I think that's where you get back to how the revenue is used. And on the federal side, I think there's a strong case to be made to target that revenue to coal-reliant communities or communities whose electricity prices would go up and households who are vulnerable to that. And on the state side, we haven't really talked about this, but half the revenue would go to the states involved. And certainly Wyoming needs the revenue. That their severance tax revenue has really gone down. They're very dependent on that. The downside, of course, is that they really need to reform their revenue system so they're not so dependent on extractive industries. But be that as it may, in the meantime, perhaps this kind of policy could cushion their blow. So thank you very much, and I look forward to the discussion.
Thanks. It's great to be here to talk about this excellent CEA report. You might have noticed I walk in late, and I'm sorry there was a air travel thing, but the wonders of RFF's webinar meant that I didn't miss a minute. This report is terrific. It's very carefully done. The CEA deserves a lot of praise for taking a careful look at these important issues. I think the other entity that really deserves a lot of praise for raising these issues is the Department of Interior. I think that looking back in many, you know, several years forward, this could well be one of the Secretary's important legacy issues in terms of really let's take a look at a very, very large program that is not necessarily consonant with all of the other goals of the administration. In the notice of intent that the Department of Interior published going over the PEIS process back in March, there's this wonderful phrase in classic Federal Register prose, which I will read. Many stakeholders highlighted the tension between producing very large quantities of federal coal while pursuing policies to reduce U.S. GHG emissions substantially, including from coal combustion. And indeed, taking a careful look at that is, I think, will be an important legacy issue for the Secretary. So, and finally, I think I just want to, introductory here, reinforce something that Michael said, which is I think he hit the nail on the head that thinking about this through a price mechanism like royalties walks the line in the right way between not having any intervention at all and not worrying about the externality costs, and on the other hand, having quantity restrictions or keep it in the ground. I think that this is a very sensible middle ground, which means that not everybody's going to like it, but that means it might be the right thing. Let me make a few points quickly. First, what the report stresses and focuses on is what I'll call the good government aspects of reform. Those are all really important. It is the job of the DOI and the BLM under the Minerals Leasing Act to make sure that it gets a fair return to the taxpayer. How can that be done? I do want to say that one does not need to reach the conclusion that any specific entity or firm has been actually engaged in malfeasance. You don't need to reach that conclusion, even though there are some who have suggested it. You don't need to endorse those suggestions to simply say we want a fair, transparent system that doesn't provide the opportunity for gaming. My particular favorite approach to that is a mesh between the first and the second CEA options, which would be based on an index of coal prices. There's well-known econometric techniques called hedonic regression that are well used in places ranging from real estate evaluation to medical. The BLS uses them for medical price index construction. They can be used here. One can subtract off transportation costs because those are observed. You can have a transparent, accurate, and observable system that simply sidesteps the gaming issues. And I think that's a good idea. Second point I would say, though, is going beyond and echoing what Michael has said and echoing what the other panelists have said, going beyond the fair value for today's taxpayers, it is the responsibility of the DOI and the responsibility of the U.S. government to think not just about today's taxpayers, but tomorrow's taxpayers and future generations as well. And I think that this number that Alan mentioned really bears pausing on. If Michael was touching on this too. If you say, what is the externality value of burning a ton of coal? That is, what would the future generation bear from burning that value, that ton of coal? Depends on the coal grade, depends on the source. $80 a ton, $90 a ton. What are we getting for that coal? Right now, $1, $1.50. We're off by two orders of magnitude. Now, you could say the social cost of carbon is twice as high, is wrong by a factor of two. Some people have said that. Okay, so it's not $80 or $90 a ton. It's $40 or $45 a ton compared to what we're getting, $1.50. You could say that's ridiculous. There's no way politically or in terms of the electricity system that anyone could stand the shock of increasing royalties by that much. That's actually a valid point. You need to ramp in. You might not want to go all the way. What I would say is, like, turn that on its head. We're off by a couple orders of magnitude in terms of the externality values produced by combusting this coal. Okay. So then the next response you might have is, well, wait a minute, isn't coal in decline? Isn't coal just going to disappear anyway? Why do we even need to do this? It's actually wrong. If you look at the EIA projections, coal has declined a lot. That's natural gas prices. Natural gas prices aren't going to go to zero. So coal is going to continue to play an important role in our energy future. It'd be irresponsible to ignore that. It'd be irresponsible not to recognize that that's true. It'd be irresponsible to shock the system in a big way. So where does that leave us in terms of specifics? Let me make a concrete recommendation. This is my personal opinion. Okay, my personal opinion. So we should adopt an index approach to valuing the prices. So it's something like the CEA 1 and 2 plan with the transportation cost adjustment with hedonic regression. Point two, leave the royalty rate, the return to the taxpayer, the good government part of this, at 12.5%. Point three is include a royalty adder that compensates for the externality value, the cost not to the current, not the benefits to current generations, but the costs imposed on future generations. Might want to make that modest for a large number of reasons, including the legal reasons that Alan in the RFF's excellent report points out, maybe 20% of the social cost of carbon. You want to phase that in so you don't shock the system. What would the results of this be? The result would be very substantial increases in royalty revenues that could help the states that are impacted. It would help Wyoming, it would help Montana, it would help Colorado, it would help Utah. And the federal component of that could help coal transition assistance in states that are impacted in the east. Another effect of this would be that it would decrease the cost of compliance with the Clean Power Plan. Another effect of this would be that it would increase increase employment a little bit in eastern and coal, because there'd be some substitution of eastern coal for western coal. So there's a number of other things that I've written about and other people have written about that would be aspects of this proposal. And I think, in short, I really am delighted that the Secretary has decided to move forward with this. I think we need to take up her invitation to go further and think about incorporating the climate externalities as well as when we think about the costs and the royalty rates.
Okay, so I'm going to moderate in the 10 minutes or so we have left. I'm going to moderate our discussion. I invite members of the audience to come up and ask questions of the panelists. And in addition to that, if people who are listening on the internet, if they want to use the hashtag AskRFF, then we'll get your tweet and we'll be able to bring that to the panel. I'd like to start off, actually, with a tweet, because the tweet comes from our new president, Richard Newell. Richard is used to be at RFF, and then he was at Duke, and then he was head of the Energy Information Agency and then administration, and then back at Duke, and now he's back at RFF, and we're very happy about that. Phil Sharp is stepping down after 10 years or so here at RFF. So Richard is asking, how do you avoid not double charging the social cost of carbon at both the mine mouth and at the point of combustion in a power plant? So I'll invite anyone who wants to jump on that.
So if I could do that, that actually is a terrific question. It's actually an important question. Let me just step back and say there are two really big analytic questions in this area that are challenging. One is the substitution of Western federal coal for non-federal coal, and that's something that requires a model to figure out. And the other one is the issue that was raised, which is what's the appropriate level so you don't actually double count. I think that sort of at an intuitive level, at a very high intuitive level, one might imagine that there's a price of carbon that is imposed by the Clean Power Plan, and then there's another price of carbon that one could impose at the mine mouth, and the total of those would be some appropriate price of carbon. Now, I want to step back from that rough intuition because things get a lot more complicated because you have to deal with the details of the implementation of the Clean Power Plan, whether or not it's implemented in a mass-based way or a rate-based way, and so forth. And I don't want to take a lot of time on that. Instead, I'll refer you to the Vulcan Report does a good job on that, and I also have an NBR working paper that takes a look at those issues.
Okay, thank you. Could we have our audience?
So Sharon Buccino with the Natural Resources Defense Council. I wanted to ask about your second big question, which was the substitution effect and whether the CEA report looked at that, what conclusions you could draw, and others may have some comments in terms of what analysis has been done on that and what more needs to be done.
Yes, we, using the model results from the IPM model, we do actually are able to look at the substitution from, say, federal to non-federal coal. That is modeled in there. All the results are in the paper. But I actually defer this to Jim, who might want to elaborate more.
The extent of substitution of federal for non-federal coal actually depends on the royalty rate. And so at the first instance, you're going to get quite a bit of substitution at low prices. As the prices go up, you're going to see less substitution. What actually happens is an interesting self-limiting process. As you drive up, as the royalty rate increases, that will naturally increase the price of non-federal coal. That'll increase production of, there'll be an increase in demand for an increase in production. But at some point then, the non-federal coal kind of caps out because it's no longer competitive with gas. So there's sort of a self-limiting point. At that point then, you see less substitution.
Okay, next.
Good morning. I'm Damon Walia, CEO of Architect Inc. I really appreciate you all having done this study. Reason I stood up and talked to you about this thing that, you know, I have some comments and also there's some questions in there. The reality with coal today is that in the private sector, when you try to monetize it, and all the experts who do the reserve certification for various resources which are used for then getting a financing. For coal, it's today not only in US but worldwide, it's almost either zero or negative. So that is the challenge federal government has today. And the reason being that we don't have the solution for coal. You all are talking about the carbon dioxide issue. The federal government funded program for CCS is fundamentally technically challenging, costly, and that's the reason for this whole controversy about national, you know, this clean power plan issue out there. The reason I've stood up here, I've spent 40 years of my life in taming coal. I've failed many times, and my company has put forward a solution which may allows to use the biotechnology approach to utilize coal to produce clean fuels as well as non-energy products for agriculture, water, waste recycling, carbon dioxide issues, and I'm operating a biorefinery right here in Virginia, which is where we are producing these products. So my question to the federal government is, in this part of the study, one, they need to also take a look at that almost 90% of the fossil fuels in form of oil, gas, and coal, there's about 90% of it is a stranded coals, which are these coal seams, they're too deep to mine. For example, according to the Department of Interior or US Geological Survey, there's about 7 trillion tons of coal out there. So the federal government needs to take a look at how to monetize, as well as it should rather take on and help solve, create solutions for coal. And that is, I think, is one of the study which I hope you will all take and how to address this issue before this, any issue about the royalties, and I agree with these things, but that's where the urgent need is today. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Does anyone want to comment on that?
I'll just say thank you for your thoughts. Those are all interesting questions to examine. Those are outside the scope of our study at this stage, but we appreciate that.
I would just chime in a little bit. I would say that the federal government's objective should be to address market failures, and that means funding basic research that the that private sector is not going to do, and to address the external cost. I don't think it should be the federal government's objective to preserve coal per se. What you want to do is find lower cost, low carbon energy sources. And the headwind for coal is that there are a lot of other options that are lower carbon and lower cost. And so what that means for coal is providing the resources to allow the communities and workers who rely on coal to do something else and build a new economic base. It shouldn't be, I think, the government's objective to put a glass case around the coal industry as it exists now through a variety of other interventions. We want the lowest cost possible climatic protection, and that may or may not mean CCS. We'll have to see, but at the moment it looks like there are going to be alternative technologies that are much lower cost.
You have a fan. Sir.
Hi, Tyson Slocum. I'm the Energy Program Director at Public Citizen. And just building on Adele's point, my question is about the transition assistance that we're going to have to give to displaced coal communities. Have there been analyses of what the price tag looks like, not just for Powder River Basin, but in other coal communities? Are there details, either domestically or internationally, of similar types of transition assistance initiatives that were successful in helping those distressed communities move on to other types of economic opportunities? Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, I would just say that the administration cares very deeply about this. We've proposed the Power Plus program to try and provide assistance to distressed and vulnerable communities. Unfortunately, it's not been funded, but we at the level that we'd like, but we feel very strongly and think that more analysis, more work needs to be done in this area.
So you set me up perfectly. I just released a paper a couple months ago. It's available on my website at brookings.edu. It's called Build a Better Future for Coal Workers and Communities, and it describes exactly the challenges facing coal-reliant communities and what an important task it will be to help these communities adjust to a lower carbon future. You know, just super back of the envelope, if you add up what looks like the threat to coal worker retiree benefits, the potential underfunding of coal reclamation, some manner of community redevelopment, training, et cetera, you're probably looking at on the order of about $36 billion over a decade. So if you had a carbon tax of about $25 going up at 2% over inflation, 4% over inflation, something like that, CBO has done a really nice score in the 2013 fiscal deficit paper. You're probably looking at about 3% of carbon tax revenues that would 3-4% that you would need to fund a robust and effective program to help coal-reliant communities and workers.
I want to use the chair's prerogative to make one statement, and then Terry, you'll be the last person because we're really at 10 o'clock. Just remember, a lot of the coal-producing states also have a lot of natural gas. So to the extent coal is disadvantaged, natural gas may be advantaged even more, and so they will gain in their economies. So Terry, do you want to ask the last short question and then short answers, and then we'll call it a day?
Okay, thank you. I'm Terry Dinan from CBO, and we do hear a lot about coal companies going out of business. So I wondered how that entered into your analysis, just in terms of, I don't know how many companies there are that are involved in this, but like these elasticities, you know, I don't know how that relates to whether or not the companies are on the margin and they might, you know, with how high of an increase they could have before they go out of business, and how the elasticity is accounted for that.
I'll answer first. That's a great question. One of the reasons that we focused on 2025 is because we're focused on longer term trends in this market and not on individual coal companies that may have done a lot of acquisitions and have a large debt burden, which has been a real problem recently. So by focusing on the longer term and by phasing this in slowly in our modeling, at least, we were able to get around those as major issues and focus on the underlying economics, which is divorced in a sense from the questions that are very much pertinent today about how the debt burdens are causing trouble and attempting to get rid of the debt burdens through the bankruptcy process.
I would just say that strictly the modeling looks at the underlying asset value, and if coal can be profitably produced from a mine, then it is, and that abstracts from the ownership and who might have to bear the cost of financial restructuring and so forth. I guess let me just make one quick response also to Tyson's question and iterate something that Adele said. That, you know, there's some view, I would say, in aspects of the environmental community that instead, well, gosh, why don't you just continue this moratorium and not have any more leasing? And I think what the important thing that misses is that it misses the revenue opportunity that could fund precisely the transitional assistance programs that Adele has written so eloquently about, and allows us to help those communities using the appropriate tools for a just transition.
Thank you very much. So let's give the panelists a hand and give yourself a hand for good questions.